everybody. It's my great pleasure to introduce you Dr. Yuan Gong. Yuan is a research scientist at MIT CSIL. He got his PhD in computer science from the University of Notre Dame, supervised by Christian Holbauer.
Polar bear.
So in the past, Yuan has done really great research, including his award in InterSpeech 2019. He got a Best Student Paper Award nomination, as well as ICNS Speech 2023, Outstanding Reviewer Award. Yuan is currently interested in computational speech audio signal analysis, including speech-based healthcare applications, audiovisual multimodality learning, and general audio web recognition. So today we're going to hear from Yuan. And yeah, you have the floor. Thank you.
Thank you so much for Tarek inviting me. And I'm super excited to introduce the topic. So starting from early this year, around February, March, we're starting to develop a new model called Audio Large Language Models. And the idea is to connect sound perception to understanding. So in my personal opinion, I think that's the smartest model I've ever developed. And I want to maybe first give them, background about my research. I don't know how many Zoom audience are there, so please turn the volume a little bit off because the videos might be a little bit loud. So given all the so we are able to, perceive various, car passing by, people speaking and footsteps, and also ambulance, a fire engine sound. I think it's a fire engine sound, and we want the machine to do the same. And the reason why we want to use audio as the input is because in the video, you don't even see the fire engine where the fire engine is, but you already know there's one coming because you listen to its horn sound. So that's the advantage of auditory perception. And previously, we developed a model called Audio Spectrum Transformer. And I also presented at the EI seminar like 2 years ago. That was something new at that time. And actually the model can do pretty well in recognizing the audio band I just played. So it knows that it's a vehicle, there's an emergency vehicle, which is a fire engine. It's a car, a traffic noise, and the wind. But if we look into details of the model actually do not know any of the labels. It only knows the label index, which is 300, 322, 307. So the output is just a vector of numbers. And then we have a data set, a label set. So we know that a class 300 maps to vehicle. We know that 322 is an emergency vehicle. And then we do the mapping. So we get these. So the model actually do not understand anything about the the meaning of the labels. It's just output the index. And also the model cannot predict unseen classes. While it should be a fire engine, the model only knows it's an emergency vehicle because that is trained on these label set. It do not generalize to, a new sound event. And also it only do audio tagging like this, do not do any unseen tasks. You cannot even ask questions about, new tasks to it. So we are not, satisfied with this kind of model, though its perception ability is pretty strong. And when we develop this model, that's the best model for this task. Ideally, the model should understand the implicit meaning of the sound events by covered by, that's fine. So by implicit meaning, I mean that if we want to ask the model what's the weather, the model should know that it's windy or rainy because it hurts the, the ring sound. And the model should know where it is recorded, right? So because there's traffic noise, there's raining sound, there's footsteps, it's likely to be an urban area. And the model should know that. And the model should know what we should do after listening to the sound. So for example, the model after here, the fire engine, the model should say that you should, side the road and stay there until the emergency vehicle has passed, connect perception to action. So this is actually the output of our audio large language model automatically. And I will very soon introduce how we did that. In addition to that, we also want the model to generalize to unseen audio classes and for new tasks. So previously, we actually have some large field called zero shot learning. The idea is that if you know the cat sound and tiger sound, and you have cheetah sound is closer to a cat sound, then when you have a new cheetah sound, you can map it to the new label set, because you know that cheetah is closer to cat. And but actually, these basically want to map the audio representation to the semantic space. In the semantic space, we know cheetah is closer to cat. The sound of cheetah is close to the sound of cat and more different from the tiger. But these kind of good semantic representation of sound is very hard to get previously, usually based on the name of the class or wiki information. But that is not sufficient. For example, I checked the lab scene model, which is a so-called small NLP model now, but actually it was a very powerful model like 2 years ago. That does not know the sound of cheetah is closer to a cat than tiger and a lion, which is understandable because we can imagine cheetah is a big cat. The sound of big cat should be similar to tiger and lion rather than a cat. But based on these kind of rationales and knowledge, the model actually should know these if it's super strong in semantic understanding. However, the lab scene model output the similarity between sound of cheetah and similarity of tiger as the highest similarity of 0.82, while the similarity of to lion is the second higher, which is 0.773. The closeness between the sound of cheetah and the sound of cat is only 0.771, which is the lowest, and that is wrong if we listen to the sound of cheetah. So my point here is that if we use conventional NLP model, we are not able to get the very good sound semantic representation. We are not able to capture the relationship between sounds. On the other hand, pre-large language model already have knowledge about the sounds even without any sound training. For example, if we ask what's the acoustic feature of a dog, it can list very detailed information. And if we ask the question about is a cheetah sound more closer to a cat or a tiger sound, that can give us the correct answer. That is, it says the vocalization of cheetah are more akin to domestic cats. And here's the reason, they have a very detailed reason. The only problem with this is GPT-4. So the only problem with these models is they do not have sound perception ability. You cannot input the audio to the GPT-4 and to ask what it is. So it only knows sound concepts, but not sound perception. And that, to be official, I also got asked GPT-4 that, do you understand audio input? It tells me no. So then we have two types of model. One model is the sound perception model on the left hand. So it has strong perception ability, but do not understand the sound. On the right hand, we have large language models. It has good knowledge about sounds, but and also reasoning ability, but no sound perception ability. So what we did is we combined them together as a new model called Listen, Think, and Understand, or LTU in short. So next, I want to discuss how we build this model and how to make it a success. There are three key components in building this model. The first is, of course, the architecture of the model. And second is the training data to train the model. And finally is the training curriculum that we use to make the model has best performance. So let's start from the model architecture. And the input to the model is a turbo that is contains one actually a pair of audio clips in the spectrogram form. So it's very easy to convert waveform to the spectrogram, and also a question or instruction. And then for the audio spectrogram, we feed it into an AST model, which is the perception model, and do some kind of polling and get these audio tokens, like A1 to A32. And then for the text, we use conventional method to first input to our tokenizer and then embedding layer to get the text embedding. And then we put them together and input it to your Llama large language model. So Llama is an open source per language large language model, has haven't seen any audio tokens before, but has already very strong text ability. And we also freeze the entire Llama model and they train a small amount of adapters on top of Llama. And then we want the model to generate this output, like romantic music being played in text form. I want to highlight that the input to the audio input to the Llama model is continuous embedding, which encodes more information than discrete values. So there's a trivial solution just to first convert the audio thing to a sentence, like a caption, and then feed it to a per text large language model, which is also fine, but that encodes less information compared to the continuous value. And also these tokens are temporarily aligned, so you can ask the model to do temporal tasks. For example, ask at which time point an audio event happens. So to train the model, we use the original large language model loss, which is token-wise cross-entropy loss with teacher forcing. By that, I mean, so we want to model to output romantic music being played, which correspond to these token IDs. And we want the first one to be, 22834, and by enforcing cross-entropy loss. But when we calculate the second, we give the ground truth of the first, that is teacher forcing, and try to maximize this objective. So which is exactly the same with the original large language model training. So I don't want to go too details, and this is actually pretty true. So the problem is that to train the model, we actually need three things. The first is we need the audio, and we need a question, and we also need an answer. So we can say that is an AQA turbo. But there's no large-scale AQA dataset on the market when we start building this system. And I don't think there's one even now. So that is a pretty challenging problem. What kind of data should we use to train, our AQA model to be smart? So you might think that should be a simple thing. We can convert, conventional audio dataset. For example, data set has labels of audio events, of ambulance, traffic noise, and also timestamps, and also caption the data set, just to convert to AQA data set. That is easy, right? So we just craft some questions and use the original label, the text form of the original label as the answer, and then we, of course, have an audio. So we can easily convert existing audio data sets to the AQA data set. However, using this rule-based method, we can only create closed-ended question-answer pairs. Namely, these questions are designed by human. So there's limited amount of tasks we have. For example, we only have four tasks, I believe. So namely, the audio event classification, try to give the labels, and audio captioning, try to generate a sentence describing an auditory event, and also temporal analysis. Although we use ChatGPT to paraphrase these questions like 100 times, these are only limited number of tasks. So after we train the model with these data, we find it's good on same task, for example, audio event classification. It's pretty good. Captioning, that's also okay. But when we come to some open-ended questions, so what is the busy signal? The model just do not respond to us. It's just telling them something irrelevant, because that is training on these data sets. So we can imagine the problem is that in a very large question space, we only cover a small portion of that. That is classification, captioning, and temporal analysis. So when the model see a new question, it basically finds the closest neighbor and just answer the default answer for that task. That is not what we need. We do not want the model can only solve fixed number of tasks. And when we ask something new, the model just do not respond to that. That's not a smart model. So ideally, we can have, you know, in the question space, we can fill up as much as possible. We want to have tons of tasks. So when there's an unseen question, the model can find a neighbor that is really similar to the question, so that model can generalize in the question space. But doing this is non-trivial. On one hand, we want to generate millions level of accurate pairs. That is impossible for human, right? Even with cloud sourcing, we cannot ask people just to listen to the audio and propose a question. And then after we preliminary try that, we find human questions are also pretty constrained. So because the first question come to our mind is likely to be, what is the audio event? What did you hear? So they do not come with very strange questions. On the other hand, if you want to apply any rule-based method, that won't be you know, as diverse as, you know, real life. So that we already tried this. We already tried to generate as, you know, use rule-based method to generate as diverse as possible, but that's just not diverse enough. So what we propose is a new method to generate AQA, what we call audio instruction generation with GPT assistance. So first we have these, you know, labels from existing data set like sound events together with timestamps, also a description. These are from existing data set. You can easily find this data set online. And we feed this to GPT 3.5 model. The problem, this is because GPT 3.5 model only understand per text. So we have to convert these, you know, labels in text format and feed to GPT 3.5. And at the same time, we have a prompt to ask GPT 3.5 to ask questions based on the meta information, which is this. So the prompt is that we first give the task ask the model to generate 10 different types of complex over open-ended questions. And we also tell it what information we were provided to it. And we also have some sample questions. And we emphasize that we need complex, diverse questions to GPT 3.5, again, at the end of the, you know, prompt. So with this method, these are the output of GPT 3.5. It's a little bit overlapped by the Zoom, but. So we can see the question is really from very diverse, from very low level. For example, this question is how would you describe the tone of the sound of accelerating engine? And the answer is the tone of the sound of accelerating engine is high pitch, short and intense. And to very high level, to what mood or atmosphere does the audio clip convey? Tells that the sense of urgency due to the sound of ambulance siren. So by these, we can generate, you know, very diverse questions. So if you force human to do this for minutes of audio, for like hundreds of cases of audio, that will be super hard. That, and I also want to emphasize again that so the input to the Llama model is continuous audio embedding. We use method only for data generation, not training. So in the training, the model only sees the continuous embedding, while the data is generated by these discrete tokens. We are not for you know, importing these text form information to Llama model during training, because that is, you know, do not contain that enough information. The model has to condition on the raw audio. And in the inference, the LT model solely use the raw audio as the answer to ask a question. So using this method, we were able to generate very diverse, you know, AQAs. So these, we show that about 96.3 questions only appear once in the 3.7 million AQA data set. So that most questions are only asked once, and also 99% of answers are unique. So using this method, for the first time, we are able to create a AQA data set of the scale 5.6 million which is based on 845K audio clips. So this data set contains two parts. The first part is the closed-ended question answer, which is about 1.9 million, and the open-ended question answer pairs about 3.7 million. So both of data are very important in our model training, because we are applying a so-called perception to understanding training curriculum. So let's rethink about our training objective. So when we ask questions, describe the sound of bell in the audio clip, we expect model to output something like the bell in the audio clip has a bright and the ringing sound. But for this answer, the model only need to decide two keywords, because based on original llama's language ability, it can already answer that the bell in this audio clip has R and sound. So these are, you know, easy things for it. Based on, it doesn't have to be conditioned on audio. Only these two things, the bright and the ringing two tokens, need to be conditioned on audio. But even the model do not attend to audio and just feel some random words here, the model still get a small penalty because other words are correct. So we cannot let the model do this thing, because the model, if the model just do some kind of imagination here, it's just as called hallucination. The model is not honestly, you know, reply something related to audio. It's basically based on its imagination, which is likely to be wrong. So in the first stage of training, we have to force model to look at the audio and condition on the audio. So in the first stage of training, we give task that it has no chance to get small penalty if it do not attend to audio. So the question in the first stage is like classified audio events and any information in the answer, model need to condition audio. And only after that, we goes to, you know, questions like open-ended questions like these, so that allow the model to do some open-ended reasoning thing. So more specifically for the training task, we start from classification and description task, which the model will get a very large penalty if do not attend to audio, and then slowly remove the constraint to all closed-ended tasks, and then to all closed-ended and open-ended tasks. And for training parameters, in the first stage, we only train the random initialized, you know, layers in the network, because both the audio encoder and the large language are already pre-trained. So we first, stably train the model, we first train the random initialized parameters and then move to all encoder and the LoRa adapters. Okay, so while the strength of the model is actually to answer free-form questions, we have to first benchmark it on closed-ended tasks, which like convention task like classification and captioning. That is because we do not want the model to generate like answer seemingly correct, but actually wrong. We want the model to be at least factually correct. So that's the, you know, baseline. So so for these proposed, we benchmark the model on all these conventional benchmarks, including classification and captioning. And we found our model is 23.6%, better than previous best audio text model, which is CLAP. CLAP is like a clip-like model. So you first, for CLAP, a clip-like model, if you want to do zero-shot learning, you have to predefine the labels that, for example, cheetah, cat, dog, stuff. But for our model, there's no need. Model just generated the output in per text format. For example, you do not need to specify, the candidates. It can directly output, it is a cheetah stuff. And on captioning, we are close to the comparable to the, so the specialized model trained only for the captioning tasks. So our LTU model is stronger than previous model in perception. And we also did some ablation studies. For example, we compare the LoRa adapters with full fine-tuning and find that if we full fine-tune the make the other large language model parameters trainable, that we dramatically lose per language ability, because it all fits to our data, which is not desired. So LoRa adapters should be used. And we also you know, try to remove the training curriculum and see the performance dramatically drops. So the training curriculum is really important to make the model to have factual correctness. And also, and another interesting finding is that even we are benchmarking on closed-ended tasks, we find that doing open-ended training is beneficial to this closed-ended training. So the idea is that learning to understand actually improves models' perception ability. So these are the numbers for the LTU model. And we also did a human evaluation on the output of LTU. Namely, we hired around 500 humans on the Amazon Mechanical Turk to compare the LTU output with GPT output, which is based on text form Guangqu's, and also the human generate output for both human questions and the GPT questions. So so the short answer is short conclusion is that in general, our model has around 80% of time that is first follow your instruction, namely ask something related to your question rather than something totally irrelevant. And the answer is factually correct. So the rate is about 80% of the time. And about 75% of human evaluators think ALTU, our model's output, is better than human output. Basically, because our model is a machine, it's not it's not as lazy as a human. The human tends to type short answers, but our model always describes things in detail. So humans, 75% of humans think our model is output is better than human output. And so that's human evaluation. So so let's see some demos. And I want to say that this is hosted as a public demo, so you can play with the model with your own audio and questions. So let's listen to these. So if we ask some basic questions, what sound is heard? The model is able to tell us that insects heard and all sound are heard. And starting some more challenging questions. So so we want the model to predict some details. About insect. So what insect is it? So the model can tell us that the insect is a cricket. Remember that for conventional models, it only maps to a predefined label set. You want to know the details, there's no way. But the LTU can tell us more details. And we can ask, is the recording likely to be recorded in morning or evening? And the model knows that it's likely to be evening because the old sound is more prominent during the night. And we can also ask, what type of video can this audio use for dubbing? And the model tells it can be used for a horror movie. So that's shows some kind of understanding ability. And the second example I want to give is this. The model appears to well. What happens to you? You look at this one. So we can. Again, ask some details about the bell sound, but really I want to show you this is that the model has some knows what it does not know. So of course our model is not doing perfectly. So it has some knowledge, has some knowledge boundary. So it could be two cases. First is that the question cannot be answered based on the audio clip. For example, you ask, what is the producer of the bell? The model shouldn't know that, right? The second case is that the question can be answered based on the audio, but our model just not able to listen to clearly. Basically, it's not a perfect model, but I want to show that in that case, the model actually tell you that it does not know rather than give you a random answer. Remember that for a conventional model, it output a vector of class that do not tell you it doesn't No, it just gave you a value anyways, right? Give you a random guess anyways. So that's another advantage of LTU model. I want to stop here to see if there's any questions on Zoom or physically. Any question about the LTU model? Yeah, go ahead.
If you put in, for example, speech, can it tell something about the tone of the speech or something like that, answer questions like this?
Yeah, yeah. So that's a great question. And that's exactly what I want to talk in the next part of the talk.
Perfect.
But that's a very good one. Other questions?
So I feel that there's still a text bottleneck in the data generation process.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, we can just use the text label of the audio and your questions as input to train a large model to answer your questions.
Mm-hmm.
So the questions and the GPT-4's questions and answers are actually based on the text of the label.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you solve this problem in the future, the text bottleneck?
So this first is a very good question, but I actually answered, you know, emphasis on this, that the data is only used for the text bottleneck is only used for data generation.
Yeah.
But when we train the model, we force the model to only see the raw audio without any, you know, text bottleneck.
Yes, but the questions, the answers to the questions,
mm-hmm,
can be answered purely based on the text bottleneck. So
mm-hmm,
the model might not actually learn extra information beyond the information contained in the labels, the text labels.
Yeah, that's true. But since we have a tons of data from different data sources, we have a larger data set with, you know, from a set of data sets. So they have bring up different labels. So the text box, so it should be, you know, conclusively include all information in the recording because they annotated data really fine-grained. For example, they give you a timestamp like this. So I would say there's no missing information in terms of audio events in some of the data set. It's quite conclusive. So the answer should be quite conclusive.
I see.
So it's not, you know, only annotated part of the audio. It's try to annotate it as much as possible, but I can understand because that is the label set is still a fixed size label set, like 500 classes. So I do not, you know, have tons of other labels. Yeah.
I see. So I think probably a way to solve this problem is let the GPT-4 to ask more questions and let the humans to answer those questions.
Mm-hmm.
So the humans listen to the audio and answers GPT-4's questions. So that avoids the text bottleneck.
That's a very good comment. We have tried this when we use AMT. So we, you know, if you look at this, we first ask the human to listen to this and answer the questions based on, you know, GPT-4 or another human. In theory, the human should, you know, generate better answers, right? Also more, you know, human-like answers. But in practice, humans are lazy. So they generate short answers, not that conclusive, you know, sometimes with broken grammar. And if you want to do minutes level annotation, you need to consider, you know, that's human.
I see.
Right. But
yeah,
it's a good point.
Yeah, yeah. A lot of money is all you need.
right. Well, even you pay a lot, you cannot guarantee the workers, you know, do a very good job for you. You still need to find someone to control the quality of the answer. In industry, probably we can do some human annotation.
Yeah.
I think that's a great one. And we probably also released the, you know, the human question answers, so you can see the difference between human answers and the GPT answers. Human answers are generally shorter and you know, less conclusive.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I will go to the next part of the talk, which about is the second generation of LTU model. So in the previous LTU model, it only listened to the audio bands and if you input some speech, it probably knows it's a speech, and probably knows it's a male speech or female speech, is loud or, you know, something like that, but does not know the speech content, which is a very important part in understanding what audio is. The reason is the AST audio encoder we use here do not encode, you know, spoken text information. So we build a new generation of model called LTOAS, which is able to jointly, to simultaneously recognize and jointly understand spoken text, that is what is being said, and then speech paralinguistics, which is how the speech is produced, like the emotion of the speaker, the gender of the speaker, the speech rate, the pitch stuff, and also the non-speech audio events like the ambulance sound, the cat sound. So we want the model to perceive and understand almost everything from the audio signals. So to do this, we have to replace the audio encoder to something that encodes spoken text. And we use automatic speech recognition or ASR model called Whisper. And we take the soft thing from the Whisper encoder, which contains continuous embedding as LTO, which will encode audio events and the speech paralinguistics, because these things have to be encoded in soft tokens. And we also have discrete spoken text from the Whisper decoder, which is basically the transcription of the speech. So we input these, the soft continuous values, the spoken text, and the questions together to the LLaMA large language model, so that the model can get all the information. So the reason why we can use a single automatic speech recognition model to encode both, like audio events, speaker information, and the spoken text, is based on off our previous work that we find Whisper is very good in doing this. For example, in this demo, we show that Whisper can transcribe both the audio events and the spoken text. Okay.
This is nice and hot, about medium high. And oh, I love that sizzle.
So you see that in the yellow ones is the audio events, and the green ones is the spoken text.
Okay, the onions have browned a little bit. It's been maybe not even 2 minutes. Now it's time to add the ground beef. And I got a half.
So these are the output of the, you know, these Whisper encoder decoder model, so we can get both information. And also, in order to train the model, you know, to understand speech, we again use the audio generation, instruction generation, but add more speech data sets. For example, we have EmoCamp data set, which is a speech emotion data set. And we have Liberty TTS data set, which contains age, speaker age information, gender information, speech style. And yeah, we also have our FMA data set, which is an open source music data set. So we, for this data set, we have music caption, music gene, of course, the lyrics, and a longer list of music genes. So we have a top one gene, and we have some sub genes as a list. So so use this information, we again prompt GPT-3.5 to generate questions. But the idea is, compared to the first generation of LTO, we have more speech data set to force the model to learn about speech. And we also benchmark on some speech, you know, tasks, for example, speech recognition, speaker emotion recognition, gender classification, speaker age prediction, and the music gene classification. So some interesting thing is our model actually beats the best, you know, speaker age prediction model, specialized model, with a pretty large margin. So the our mean absolute error is 7.3 years, while previous best model is around 9.4. And our model in zero-shot learning, the music gene classification is almost double the previous best, you know, collab model, you know, 2 times. So that's shows the advantage of our model on these tasks. I don't want to go too details. I want to show the difference between LTO and LTOS, which the first one do not understand speech, and how that impacts the, you know, performance in open-ended question answering. So let's listen to this.
To the left, the second time through, they'll do the same move to the right. We'll do a series of about five moves. Here we got a 6'9 kid. I expect him to make the same move. Good job.
So this one, you can hear that there's basketball bounce, and there's also spoken text, which is, you know, try to instruct the player how to play. And if we ask LTM model, what can be inferred from the audio? The model says there's a basketball game or practice playing nearby, and there are people talking and making noise while playing the game. The reason why it says like that is because it seems the people talking and the basketball game are you know, independent, do not know the relationship between the spoken text and the audio bands. But LTO AS can, you know, output that it knows that the speaker is giving instructions to the players on how to perform certain moves on game. And also it knows the background sound of basketball bounce, and it knows that the speaker is encouraging the players and provide positive feedback for their performance. So that is, you know, much more information compared to the first generation of LTM model that do not understand speech. And if we ask some more questions, like what could be job of the speaker? The first generation of LTM model said it could be a coach, a referee, or commentator, among other possibilities. Basically, they don't know what is the spoken text. It can just make guesses. So, it also knows it's probably a too hard problem for it, so it just needs a few possibilities. While the LTO AS model, no, certainly it's a coach or instructor, because that is from the, you know, spoken text. I also want to highlight that it also knows that it's a basketball coach. So if you only feed the spoken text with GPT-4, probably it does not know it's basketball coach, because didn't hear the basketball. It could be also a volleyball coach or other, you know, ball games. And if we ask what's the emotion of the speaker, the LTO AS model can tell you the confident and encouraged, encouraging the speech. So that's the advantage of LTO AS over LTU. And we can see some more demos. For example, this one.
No, the whole situation, though, was I don't mean to be a pessimist. I'm not usually a pessimist, but I felt very lose-lose about the whole thing. Very glass half empty. It was that if you won, mm-hmm. Well, first off, if you lost, you lost. But if you won, I was so anxious about getting up and talking in front of people that I thought I still sort of lose, you know?
So LG model can capture that the high pitch and the half speed of the speaker, and the show that suggests some kind of excitement or, you know, tension. And also based on spoken text, can, you know that the speaker is not a good public speaker because of the spoken text. And if we ask the model to give five suggestions to the speaker, it can also, you know, list some of, take a deep breath before speaking, something like that. And the second sample is the music. Again, please turn your volume a little bit down for Zoom participants. So for this music, the model knows it's a music, punk rock music, and also knows it's a strong beat, distorted guitar riffs, and the lyrics is about some kind of rebellion and defiance, which align with the gene or culture. Yeah.
Sorry, I just thought of this question as you were saying this. I've seen a bunch of these like vision aligned llama models, mm-hmm. and they sometimes have these like learned biases in the text distribution. Like here, basically the answer of like what the lyrics are about fits really well with the genre of the music. Have you tested like a punk song with lyrics that have like nothing to do with that, mm-hmm. and see like if the bias of like, oh, all punk music has this type of lyrics sort of persists, or if it's like picking out like how strong the audio signal is as opposed to the like genre signal.
So you mean the model only relies on lyrics to make the prediction of the gene of the music?
No, the other way around. Like it sees the genre and it's like, okay, then it has to be like this type of like music or something.
So basically only listen to the, you know, melody, noise, you know, punk music.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's a good one. So in the training data, we explicitly have some so-called joint audio speech data set. So speaking for the music, when we prompt the GPT 3.5, we force the model GPT-3.5 to generate questions, need to consider both, you know, audio part and the lyric part to make the, you know, answer. So that is not easy. We try many prompts to try to enforce GPT-3.5 to ask questions require a joint understanding. So in the training data, we explicitly do that and expect the model to consider that. But I agree that it's hard to say that the model is making a very good balance between these two modalities, two parts. And more or less, it's kind of focused on one of them and, you know, ignore the other. But I would say, you know, more likely it relies on the lyrics and rather than the audio. Yeah. And we can suggest a title for the music. And interestingly, also, you know, try to find a keyword from the lyrics and also a slash the punk rock on them. So trying to combine, you know, the information of speech and, you know, the audio thing. And we ask if it, we can play this in a primary school. The model says no. So that's another sample. And finally, we tried some conventional tasks. Is that to extract information from announcement.
Transfer point for the Metro Purple Line to Wilshire Western. Boarding platform is located downstairs. This train's destination is Union Station.
So conventionally, we have like a spoken language understanding model to do this task, to try to figure out the, you know, key information from this audio clip. For example, we ask, what's the boarding platform located? It can tell us downstairs and what's the station transport to. It tells me the Metro Purple Line, something like that. So our model can also finish tasks for conventional SEO tasks. So that's concludes my talk. So we first built LTM model, which is the first audio large language model that bridges sound perception with understanding. And it's also a unified model for many audio tasks. I tend not to say all audio tasks, so to say many audio tasks. But our goal is to, can be generalized to, as much as possible. And also generalized to unseen sound classes and tasks. On top of LTU, we further build LTOAS. Basically, we want the model to simultaneously understand general audio events together with speaker paralinguistics and spoken text to combine them all. Had a joint understanding, try to understand everything, from the audio signals. Yeah, so that's all I have for today. I want to thank to my collaborators, Alex and Hongyin and Jim Gaza from MIT, and Leonard is from MIT IBM Lab. I also want to say that Hongyin is currently on the job market for a faculty position. He is the, large language model hero underneath his work. So I want to do some, promotion for him. Okay, so I want to stop here and see if there's any questions. Go ahead.
So how would you sort of extend the LTU-AS architecture to take in the vision and also like other kind of arbitrary scene understandings from like point cloud data and like robotic transform motion, that kind of stuff?
Yeah. So that's a very good question. In my point of view, that if we want a runnable model, it will be pretty simple. Like if we can have a vision encoder here or a cloud point encoder here, then we can contain them all together, and we just generate some data, just some instruct turning data, then we can make the model work. But the hard thing is that try to really get a connection between these modalities. Know which is correspond to which, like the bird in the image corresponds to the chirping sound, which is a non-trivial thing, especially when you scale up the modalities. But yes, I think that's something durable, especially when we now have very strong vision large language model and we also have audio large language model. The way we only need to connect them together. Yeah.
Okay. So one aspect of human audio understanding that's missing here is spatial perception. So any thoughts about adding that? Because right now, without having to know which side the ambulance is coming from, I'm not going to be able to act on that information.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah, that's a very good question. So there are conventional tasks for like to sound localization, try to know where you are. Basically, we need to add these abilities to the, you know, to the audio encoder. We haven't tried that, but I don't know if Whisper Encoder also encodes that information, because that will request make possibly multi-channel audios. If that is important, we can certainly, you know, adapt or adjust the audio encoder to encode like multi-channel audio information, and also do some kind of spatial instruction turning training. And I think that's totally possible. The problem is our Whisper encoder only takes single channel audio, not multi-channel audio. But that is, we do have multi-channel audio encoder on the market. We just need to replace that here if that is important. Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah.
I have a question about the training curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
So going from the L2U to L2U AS, for instance,
mm-hmm.
did you add the Whisper on top of the previous LTU training, or does it start from scratch? I was just curious if you could train everything from scratch, or do you think like actually adding things, like if you are adding his LiDAR point cloud, would that be a brand new model, or is it better to do things one at a time?
So the answer to the question is for LTOS, we'll train from scratch. That is because the architecture is different. So the only thing we can, you know, get from LTOS probably is the LoRa adapters. So because the audio encoders are, you know, different. So we have to train it from scratch. But come to your question, I think that's a very good one about the continuous training and which point should we start. I would say that if you start from Pro Audio and then add, you know, spoken text in, it probably, you know, either goes to the audio side or to the speech text side. Because for audio, you train with more audio data. For speech, that is the last stage of, you know, the last stage of a training. So it will either go to more audio oriented or speech oriented. So when we train the data, we try to get a balance between the speech training data and audio training data. Try to not let the model to go too deep to one direction. And about, you know, if we consider other modalities, can we start from LTO checkpoint? That is, I think that's totally possible, but the challenge is, again, the implementation. How can we, you know, combine, you know, start getting the weight from a pre-trained model if the architecture is different? So that is maybe the problem we need to solve before we can, you know, do continuous training.
And then do you think the order would matter in terms of like the speech and audio, the training order?
That's what I'm not sure. That's a good question. No, I don't know. What we did is we actually tried the model only with speech training, or with only audio training, and benchmark with our LTOAS model. So the idea is if you only trained with audio data, then you get better performance, slightly better performance on audio. Performance, and if you only train with speech data, then you get better on speech tasks. But for tasks that require both audio and speech understanding, you train both, you of course, get a better performance. The order of speech and audio, I haven't thought of that. Maybe a better method is just to do a full mix to train the model. Yeah, you have a question?
So I just wonder, so the output feature of Whisper Encoder, has all the text information.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason why we need a Whisper decoder is it because the Llama doesn't have the capability to understand it?
Yeah, that's a very good question. There are different types of automatic speech recognition model. So for the Whisper model, the encoder decoder are quite evenly, you know, size model. So actually the decoder has two times larger parameters than the encoder. So that's a pretty heavy decoder. For some AS model, the decoder is just a one linear layer so that we can just abandon them. And for that kind of, you know, AS model, we can probably just remove the decoder and only output the input and output of encoder to large language model, and that will learn an AS model. I already saw papers doing that. That's pretty durable. Because the decoder of that ASR model is just one linear layer. And you ask the large language model to learn one single linear layer, that's easy. But the problem with Whisper is that the decoder is actually a pretty large model. And Whisper itself is trained on about 680K hours of speech data. So that is not you know, doable by us. That's you know, developed by OpenAI. So we have no results to you know, reproduce the Whisper model, especially in the training diagram. So we have to you know, keep the decoder here. That is especially for the Whisper model, because that is a very large one. It's two-thirds of the parameters are in the decoder. Yeah. So if we remove that, we are trying to force large language model, basically the LoRa adapters, to learn the you know, decoder, which is not feasible in my point of view. Yeah. But for different AS, another ASR, it's possible. Yeah, go ahead.
So follow-up question to that. Since you have both encoder and decoder, is your system still have the capability of transcribing? Has it lost it?
Oh, it has. Yeah.
It has.
Okay. Yeah.
In the full and one of the word error rates for that transcription.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So we have the
okay.
Speech recognition numbers. But interesting thing is that the word error rate is actually worse than its internal Whisper word error rate. The reason is that we find the large language model has a very strong prior, so it occasionally changes the spelling, and in more error cases, it just add a comment after the you know, spoken text, just try to add some comments on, you know, what if, even though we only have transcribed audio to speech, spoken text, I still, you know, do add a comment. For example, the speaker is happy about
that. So you're
that,
saying
you know.
All that extra, the word rate is because of insertions?
Not exactly. It occasionally will change the spelling. So that's, you know, the placement, substitution error. But the original Whisper, whatever it on this data set is 3.5. So there's a 1.4 difference. But still, we actually very much want to model have the speech recognition ability. That also, in some cases, could be useful. For example, we want to only transcribe the first part of the speech, or we tell the model it's, you know, it's recorded in a TED talk about biology. So possibly it's better in a specific domain. But yes, the model can do ASR.
I was reading a question from YouTube. So guy was asking, this is Sam Liu from the University of Hamburg. Can you detail in detail describe the metrics which you get penalty for the LTU when it's not getting inside the keyboards as an answer? Can you describe the metrics for the LTU for when it's not getting you inside answers?
Give me one answer?
Inside.
Give me inside for answer. So we do not any have this, you know. How to say that?
There's no like online loop, there's more of a passive training. So,
It's not like, you know, like an agent. We do not apply any kind of these, you know, smart loss or you know, high level loss. The only loss we apply is the cross entropy loss, which is a very trivial one. But I think that question is interesting. So, we can make the model as an agent, so we can penalize different types of questions. Basically, try to build a reward model for the actor, but we didn't do it at all in this model. So training can be done by everyone, so that's low cost training.
In your where you're showing the WER, you did that with liver speech with clean. I assume in your training you have a lot of samples where you have noisy speech data.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that you might do better than Whisper because your model knows what sound events are there, their timestamps,
well,
and the speech?
Yeah. So that's a very good question. We of course want to do that, but to be honest, I don't think the model can do that because we are giving the model very ready spoken text as the input. So instead of you know give an internal representation to the large language model, so these really do not you know the model really only need to learn identity mapping from the input to the output for ASR tasks. So I don't think the model can do very strong on that. But if we have, you know, try to remove a few layers of the Whisper decoder, giving soft, you know, input to the large language model, then it's likely to be possible. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
I'm just wondering, like, your number of audio tokens. So at what point is the time context important? Like, I don't know, did you do some studies on giving just a very small segment of the flow versus the full segment of your test set and see how the accuracy changes? I'm just curious.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So in reality, we want the model to take as long input as possible or variable input as, but when we train the model, we only fix the data into 10 seconds. And the inference stage, we usually fix 10 seconds. If it's more than 10 seconds, the model will still work, but we haven't benchmarked the numbers for that. Likely, it will have a job, especially because of the context is too long and then unseen the training data. Constrained by our computational resources, if we make this infinitely long, then we train the model slower. But really, not a specific design to keep it 25. It's just because we can only afford 25. If we can afford 50, I will input 50. We'll try to hit the limit of our computation. Okay.
So I think let's give a round of applause.
I also encourage you to try to play with the model since we already hosted the online, online demo. Should I have a quick read?